Welcome. We're so pleased that you are able to join us for worship today. I wonder what your concerns and thoughts are as you come to worship during this week. In a number of schools around Penzance, young people and staff have been thinking about relationships, how we're linked with each other across the world, our responses and our responsibilities to those who are fleeing from war. We've been thinking about what we have to offer and what is right and compassionate, what's right to do for us and for others in our community. Some of the schools in Penzance are not only looking to see what school places are available to refugees, but what each member of the school community could do to help and welcome others who might be coming from the Ukraine. In the Bible reading this week, we learn something of God's relationship with people. His relationship is that of great love, but also contains some awareness of our fragility. Hence we hear those warnings from God, his continuous forgiveness and patience with us when we get it wrong, and all the times that he nurtures us and helps us to start again. Jesus in the gospel calls each one of us to repentance, to turn again, to start again. And he reminds us in the parable of the fig tree that God nurtures us and helps us even when we get it very, very wrong. Perhaps this week we can allow the Bible reading to remind us not to be complacent, not to think that we can't do anything, but to listen to God's word and to be ever mindful of the love of God. And if we do that, and as a result, we might in turn try to offer some of that love to those who need it.
God of all compassion, Father of all goodness, to heal the wounds our sins and selfishness bring upon us, you bid us turn to fasting, prayer, and sharing with our sisters and brothers. Let your compassion fill us with hope and lead us through a Lent of repentance to the beauty of Easter joy. Amen.
And a reading now from the Bible. And if you're wanting to follow the reading, you can find it in Luke's Gospel in chapter 13. Some people arrived and told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with that of their sacrifices. At this, Jesus said to them, "Do you suppose that these Galileans who suffered like this were greater sinners than any other Galileans? They were not, I tell you. No, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did. Or those 18 on whom the Tower of Siloam fell and killed them, do you think they were more guilty than all the other people living in Jerusalem? I tell you, they were not. No, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did." Jesus told them this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for the fruit on it, but he found none. He said to the man who was looking after the vineyard, "Look here, for 3 years now I have been coming looking for fruit on this fig tree and finding none. Cut it down. Why should it be taking up ground?" "Sir," the man replied, "leave it one more year and give me time to dig around it and to manure it. Then it may bear fruit next year, and if it doesn't, then perhaps cut it down."
It feels to me as if our gospel reading needs a red triangle with an exclamation mark inside it as its heading. But come to think of it, life as a whole seems pretty much like that at the moment, carrying a hazard sign. So probably it is a word for our times. In his book about Jesus, Luke tells of this incident following on from a long section of Jesus teaching both his disciples and often a large crowd of other people, people curious to know more about this man who was causing such a stir. And in one translation, that chapter is headed "Warnings and Encouragements." And that describes well the mixed bag of teachings the passage contained. And here in chapter 13, Luke rounds off that section with a little cameo about a couple of recent news items. A bloody massacre of some Galileans made by occupying Roman forces in the sacred temple in Jerusalem. And a tragic accident in which 18 people died beneath a collapsing tower. Could have been part of any news bulletin on our television screens in 2022. Little changes as the centuries unfold. But Jesus sensed behind their passing on of these juicy snippets, in the absence of TV coverage, of course, that was more than a hint of holier-than-thou smugness. They wanted to distance themselves from needing to fear such calamity. Jesus was having none of it. He immediately responded with a pointed question concerning each event. "Do you think that the Galileans were worse sinners than other Galileans? Or that the Siloam victims were worse than all the other folk in Jerusalem? I tell you, no." And without pausing for breath, he continued, "But unless you repent, you too will all perish." He wanted to expose both their playing of the blame game and their complacency. They wanted to distance themselves from criticism or accusations. They saw themselves as upstanding citizens, careful followers of the law of Moses, and standing apart from people like those Galileans. There was a north-south divide in Israel at that time, as there is in the UK today. Northerners from Galilee were often regarded with disfavor and suspicion, since their relative lack of prosperity fostered unrest, not to say sedition. These questioners clearly thought themselves above such things. But Jesus warned them to open their eyes and think again about their society and the way they lived their lives. He had just previously been scorning their blindness to the state of things around them, marveling that they could read the weather, but not the signs of the times. He told them it was time to repent, to have a change of heart, a new take on life, if they wanted to escape a calamity themselves. Many times in his teaching, he warned people to be watchful and alert because they were living in perilous times. It's quite probable that he foresaw, as a shrewd reader of people and events, the awful years leading up to AD 70, when, following an abortive insurrection, the Romans utterly destroyed the temple and city of Jerusalem as a reprisal. As Jesus had specifically predicted of the temple when he heard people admiring its splendor, that not one stone would be left upon another. Think destruction of cities in Ukraine this month, and you get the right idea. It was a terrible event, and his was a grave warning. The crowd he was addressing would have contained prominent civic figures, because in Jewish society, the religious Mosaic law was also civil law, and religious leaders, therefore, were their political rulers. Think present-day Iran for comparison. So his message was addressed to both public figures and ordinary people. He was urging all of them to look at how things were. A huge gulf between rich and poor, jobs for the boys, a flawed delivery of the legal system, which disadvantaged the poor, and money talking. If they had eyes to see, he said, there was no room for smug complacency. They were all implicated and could face God's judgment. However, all is not lost, because Jesus continues with a little moral tale about a fig tree with no figs. After three barren years, the tree's owner wanted it out. He no longer wanted to give it space. Luckily for the tree, though, the gardener was knowledgeable and fair-minded, and he stands for God in this story. "Give it another chance," he said. "Give me one more year to feed and tend it, and then decide." The tree presumably had its stay of execution, pulled up its figurative socks, and produced some figs. Jesus wanted to say that there was still time for them to change both their individual thoughts and actions and their social policies, so that well-being and prosperity might return to their land. Are we not also at a place in the life of our nation and our global affairs when we desperately need a rethink and a resetting of our moral and economic compass? That is what Jesus means by repentance. Stop, look, think, and change course. We live in a society where, as private citizens, we can have a voice, and we can influence affairs by our buying power. Are we willing, during Lent 22, to pause long enough to ask God to show us what needs to be changed, personally and socially, and to give us grace to follow where he leads us? Maybe that's what it means to receive the TLC which the gardener gave the tree, trusting God to enable us to change both individually and in our common life together.
And now to our time of prayers. And wherever you are, please, in your minds and thoughts, bring your concerns to God. Many of us are following the Archbishop's Lent book this year, and we're thinking about justice. These prayers are based on that book. So we pray. And so we think about our world, and perhaps now we think about the place that we live. So where the hungry go unfed, while the privileged gorge themselves, where the poor go begging, while the rich amass greater fortune, in our world where tyrants have bitten the dust, but their successors prove no better, God of justice, we ask you to show yourself to us. And we pray for the situation in the Ukraine and for all refugees. So where the refugee is not accorded dignity, where those who are disadvantaged are excluded, for those who are disabled that are left on the margins, and when people's gender or race, religion are grounds for suspicion or confer unmerited privilege, God of justice, show yourself to us. And in a world at a difficult time, we pray for those who speak for the voiceless, for those who will defend the persecuted, for those across the world who protest for a fairer world, and those who practice simpler living. And we pray for those whose faith in Jesus makes them suspected. God of justice, show yourself. And so we pray for ourselves, our own resolve, to live as Christ lived, and to bring justice for others. And so for us, that we might serve and love you with our body, soul, and mind. God, hear our prayer, the prayer of our thoughts, the prayers of our voice, the prayers of our action, and make us all willing agents of your gracious purpose. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so, the peace of the Lord be always with you. We're coming now to the time of the service where we remember the meal Jesus shared with his friends the night before he died, before he went on to rise again from the dead. So you might like now to go and get a small portion of bread and some wine and just place it in front of you. As I now say, a prayer of blessing over these gifts. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts and let us give thanks to the Lord our God. What is right, it's our duty, our joy, at all times, in all places, to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. And now in Lent, we give you thanks, because through Jesus, You've given us a spirit of discipline that we may triumph over evil and grow in grace. And so with angels and with archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy. Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And so hear us, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Through him accept our sacrifice of praise and grant that by your power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord. In the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. He gave you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, after supper, he took the cup. He gave you thanks, and he gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so accept through him this offering of our duty and our service. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, in the presence of your divine majesty, fill us with your grace and heavenly blessing, and nourish us with the body and blood of your Son, that we may grow into his likeness, and made one by your Spirit, may we become a living temple to your glory. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And so as we prepare to receive the bread and wine, a prayer of preparation. Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs from under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation, and you share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that we may live in him and he in us, so that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Amen. The blood of Christ keep you in eternal life. Amen.
In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest droughts and storms. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest droughts and storms. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, scheme of man, can never pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
And to our blessing prayer as we go out this week. Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, to take up your cross and to follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this week, this Lent, and for always. Amen.